InvestingIdeas.com podcast.
Good afternoon. Welcome to another episode of InvestorIdeas.com podcast. In today's podcast, I'll be going over a few public company announcements from Fire and Flower Holdings Corporation, trading on the TSX as FAF and the OTCQX as FFLWF. Canopy Growth Corporation, trading on the TSX as Weed and the NASDAQ as CGC. Delek Holdings Incorporated, trading on the CSE as DELC and the OTCQB as DELCF, as well as Ketamine One Capital Limited, trading on the NEO as MEDI and the OTC as KONEF. Now, I will warn you in advance, in a couple of these announcements, I go a little bit off the rails. If you've listened to my podcast before, you've definitely heard me say some pretty crazy, weird shit in the past, and this podcast is definitely no exception, so you've been warned in advance. First, looking at Fire and Flower Holdings Corporation and its wholly owned subsidiary High Fire Incorporated, who announced the acquisition of certain assets from subsidiaries of WikiLeaf Technologies Incorporated, trading on the CSE as Wiki, which is an online platform for cannabis enthusiasts and consumers, and it's as part of their innovative new digital strategy focused on enhancing the company's proprietary data-driven retail platform. Now, WikiLeaf, which generates significant user traffic through engaging content and domain name strength, will be boosted through the incorporation of HiFire's unique data-driven technology solutions into its existing platform. HiFire will transform the WikiLeaf website into a virtual online dispensary for cannabis and accessory products, utilizing the same e-commerce proprietary technology platform that powers the Fire and Flower retail network. Accessory products will be fulfilled through Fire and Flower's agreement with Humble and Fume, trading on the CSE as HMBL, announced last month. So the key aspect of this new digital strategy is that HiFire will create white-labeled online dispensaries fulfilled initially by the Fire and Flower retail network that can then be expanded on by other cannabis dispensaries and delivery channels both in Canada and the US. And in addition, users of all white-labeled websites will be enrolled into Fire and Flower's proprietary Sparks Perks membership loyalty program, expanding upon its ability to capture a high level of engagement and understanding of cannabis consumer preferences and habits in both Canada and the US. HiFire's expanded digital strategy offers a significant opportunity to expand the company's e-commerce revenue channels through an asset-light and highly scalable model both in Canada and the US, shared Trevor Fencott, the Chief Executive Officer of Fire and Flower. Now, the branded online dispensary model is accretive to our retail channel as it offers the opportunity to capture new customers and drive an additional stream of high-margin revenue through our HiFire platform. So, Fire and Flower Holdings Corporation, I've talked about them a lot, especially with their HiFire program. They're a company that's really focused on the cutting edge technology of cannabis retail. They've been well ahead of the curve of most other competitors within the retail space in Canada, and they're even quite ahead of the curve of most retail companies in the US. Now with this new strategy, especially partnering with WikiLeaf right now and potentially more companies in the future, again, they've already partnered with Humble and Fume. They're really focusing on, I think, where the cannabis industry is going to end up, which is in an online retail platform. We've seen the difficulties that some brick and mortar retail chains are already facing within the Canadian market. The same isn't really, it's not quite the same in the US, and that's mainly just due to the entire setup of the US cannabis industry versus the Canadian industry. Obviously, there's a much bigger population in the US. There's much more population density in most of these areas that the dispensaries are in. The licenses have been granted in a much smarter way in most states, not all states, but most. And these same implementations are not quite being followed in the Canadian market. So you've seen lots of cannabis dispensaries in Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, really eating shit over the last year to 2 years. And even some of the ones in Ontario and BC in certain districts and in certain areas have not been getting these type of through traffic that they were expecting. The BC and government-owned cannabis stores, whether in BC or in Ontario, have been doing quite poor by comparison to their private counterparts. And I think a lot of this comes down to the just overall implementation of retail, how these companies are setting up their stores, how they're training their staff, what type of products they're carrying, etc. But Fire and Flower Holdings, again, has been really paying attention to what the hell's going on with consumer preferences and consumer trends. Through their Sparks program, they have access to a shit ton of data on the Canadian retail landscape. They're moving into the US as well through certain partnerships. So I think that for them as a company, they definitely have a finger on the pulse of what this industry is going to look like over the next few years. And when you are looking at just all retail in general, whether it's cannabis or shoes, everything is moving to online categories. Everything is moving to delivery options. Everything is moving to a much more convenient system of distribution chains. And I do think that that's what Fire and Flower is anticipating here. I think that this is going to be potentially a crazy big setup for them. Obviously, it's going to take a little bit of while for this to be adopted on a mass scale. But I do think that most people right now are looking for most of their cannabis products and most of their cannabis knowledge through online platforms, partnering with WikiLeaf especially, as so many people are already going to WikiLeaf just to gain information on which cannabis products they should buy, what is the current trends in the industry. Because the main thing here is that most cannabis consumers, whether you're looking at the US or Canada, are still very unsure of which products to buy, what dosage they should be taking personally, where they should be going, which questions they should be asking. And so a lot of them are doing their research online before entering into stores. I can attest to this firsthand working in cannabis retail myself. That many customers come into the store phones loaded. They just simply are showing you a screen of what they're looking for because they're even too nervous or forgetful of the product that they are looking for. And a lot of these brands have stupid or strange names, which is a big problem I've talked about a lot of times with brand recognition, both in Canada and the US. You still don't really have a lot of people who actually remember what the hell the company is that they're buying these products from. Most people are still saying, I'm looking for a sativa, I'm looking for a CBD product, I'm looking for X, Y, or Z, and it's very simplistic terms. And that could be more so in the Canadian market than the US, because I do think it's a little bit more consumer educated than the Canadian counterpart. But still, especially as more and more people come into this industry, and there is still a huge percentage of both the US and Canadian population that are still untapped when you're looking at the cannabis industry. Many of these people are still skeptical about this industry. Many of these people are still waiting until it gains more acceptance. Even in the US, there's many people waiting for federal legalization before they're willing to trust many of these cannabis companies. And I do think that that creates a really great entry point for a company like Fire and Flower and their partnership with WikiLeaf here is that, again, they know that consumers are going to be going to these types of websites to gain information. And if they can suddenly then buy directly from the information site, right where they're already looking, they're going to. And especially if it offers delivery programs, which now basically all of Canada and the US do offer. And I mean, obviously, there are some difficulties, I think, within the U.S. over how many of these online dispensaries you might need to make, probably on a state-by-state basis and partnering with each state's individual delivery platform. But that sort of roadmap has already been laid out, as many companies are already doing that in the U.S. So I think this is going to be a real game changer for Fire and Flower Holdings Corporation if this gets implemented properly and if they can manage to gain the right attention quick enough. But I think that this is something that many other retailers should be looking at. And if you're looking at investing or paying attention to retail-focused companies in Canada or the U.S., this is the type of stuff you have to be looking at now, is are they aware of the changing of the guard that is going on with just general retail trends? And is this company prepared to optimize itself like Fire and Flower is doing right now? And are they going to be too late? We saw the same thing happen with COVID-19 when you had all these stores that were somehow immediately held back by all the restrictions implemented from COVID-19 lockdowns. And some companies, for instance, Fire and Flower, that already had online platforms, that already had delivery in the works, were able to launch these programs quickly and effectively and reap the benefits. And the same thing in the US, some companies were already trying to implement online delivery, were already trying to implement touchless options, already trying to implement an easier in-store or out-of-store experience. And those companies, again, were able to jump ahead of some of their competitors who were had to implement these just out of the blue. And I think this is something that definitely needs to be paid attention to in the cannabis retail market. So very good looking for Fire and Flower Holdings Corporation, for WikiLeaf Technologies, for Humble and Fume. I think that this partnership is going to work very beneficially for all three companies and for any of the other partners that Fire and Flower is working with. I think that this will also give them access, or at least push more LPs in their direction to have exclusive partnerships with the Fire and Flower Holdings Corp chain. They've already done that in the past, and I think that that will be something they continue to do, especially if they start getting aggressive sales online. But again, this is something, a general trend that everyone who is focusing on cannabis retail anywhere in the world needs to be starting to pay attention to. And again, I would say that Fire and Flower has been very smart out of the gate to pay attention and use that Sparks Reward program to actually understand consumer preferences and not just have these sort of bullshit concepts of what consumers are looking for or what trends they should be following. Again, other companies have been basing this off of, you know, a research team that they hired who didn't really give them the information that was all too groundbreaking, and then they were too late to market. Whereas again, I think Fire and Flower has probably one of the biggest assets within the Canadian retail market, which is access to a huge data set, which is real and actually coming directly from customers. Now, in another recent article from MJ Biz Daily, and I really appreciate MJ Biz Daily for doing their work. Obviously, MJ BizCon coming this year, they're awesome. But they reported on Canopy Growth Corporation, trading on the TSX as weed and the NASDAQ as CGC, whose executives received more than 4 million Canadian or 3.2 million US dollars in cash bonuses after making solid progress in the year, according to a regulatory filing, even as the company lost 1.7 billion Canadian and laid off hundreds of workers. The Smith Falls, Ontario-based company disclosed the executive compensation figures for the fiscal year 2021 in a proxy statement set ahead of its annual general meeting scheduled for September 14th via webcast. Now, for fiscal 21, which ended in March 31st, the board approved short-term incentive plan bonuses totaling $4 million for five of the company's top executives. And the company's long-term incentive plan bonuses, typically granted annually in March, were awarded in June of this year. On a go-forward basis, we have determined to fix the regular timing of our annual LTI grants to occur in June for each year beginning in fiscal 2022, the proxy noted. Now, as such, no LTI awards were granted in fiscal 2021, with the prior LT1 grants having been made in late March 2020 at the end of fiscal 20. Now, in an emailed statement, a company spokesman told the MJ Biz Daily directly that Canopy Growth's executive compensation support our strategy of attracting and retaining top talent that is necessary to support the company's ambitious growth plans and its structure to ensure close alignment between the interests of shareholders and leadership. So, the company uses four performance measurements related to the corporate objectives to help guide short-term bonus payouts where executives earn an annual cash bonus. Free flow cash has the heaviest weight with 50% among the performance measures, followed by net revenue 20%, adjusted EBITDA 20%, and individualized objectives, which was 10%. According to the proxy, Canopy aimed for a net revenue of $455 million, but came in at $414 million. Free cash flow was negative $478 million, or half the shortfall the company anticipated. Adjusted EBITDA, which serves as a measure of profitability, came in at negative $258 million, a slightly worse performance compared to the company's objective of negative $246 million. Now, the short-term cash bonuses amounted to $2.2 million to David Klein, $579,000 for Mike Lee, Chief Financial Officer, $659,000 for Raed Kovacek, President and Chief Product Officer, $360,000 for Julius Grant, Chief Commercial Officer, and $351,000 for Phil Scher, Chief Legal Officer. And according to the proxy statement, Canopy's Compensation Committee affirmed that the executive leadership team performed well in progressing the company's revised CPG strategy and reorienting towards a path of reduced financial losses and sustained success, all while acknowledging the challenging environment created by COVID-19 pandemic. The executives also received grants on June 9th as part of the annual LTIP, and those ranged from 22,000 options to 11,000 share-based awards. For share to 139 options and 69,000 share-based awards for Klein. And the share-based awards were granted in form of the performance share units. The number of PSUs granted represents 100% of the target number of PSUs. The minimum PSU award is equal to 50% of the target number of PSUs. And the maximum PSU award is 150% of the target number of PSUs. Now, going forward, the filing adds that half the executive's long-term incentive plans grants will consist of restricted share units and performance share units in fiscal 21, and no performance conditions were imposed on share unit award grants of March 2020 due to the difficulty of established reasonable performance metrics due to the impacts of the COVID-19 outbreak. And this is a big thanks to Matt Lamers of MJ Biz Daily for producing such a great article. So, Canopy Growth really just starting to dig themselves their own grave. Again, they have not had a really great last 2 years. And I definitely do not think that moves like this are really going to be doing them any favors in the long run. I think that they're a company that's already under a lot of scrutiny. Again, I talked yesterday about how Seth Rogen's brand is no longer going to be working with them, focusing on their U.S. operations and then relaunching into Canada. And again, there's that is, you know, mutually agreed upon, but there's a lot sort of under the surface there that speaks to a different story. And this is going on with a lot of Canopy Growth's brands. And this is a company that, again, had a huge, crazy investment from Constellation Brands, really betting big on the beverage side of this industry. And while beverages are doing okay in Canada, they're doing pretty poor in the US. And in general, even in Canada, they're still only taking up a small percentage of the overall sales category in cannabis products. And I will say the Canopy Growth beverages don't even beat most of the competitors. There are other beverages out there. And again, houseplant beverages were one of their highest selling beverages that they had on the market. The Tweed brand is not doing super awesome. It's doing okay in Ontario, and that's about it. And these are things that I think are adding up to some real problems. And I think that this is the same problem that a lot of these large scale LPs in Canada are running into. Again, you look at Aurora, you look at Aphria, they're not exactly nailing it at the moment. And I think that you're continuing to see that there's more scrutiny under these companies. The brand recognition that they were hoping for has not happened. Really, the only brands for all of them that have been successful have been the small subsidiary brands that they've bought up. And I do think that, again, if they continue to act in this fashion, there's going to be some long-term problems, and these companies are again setting themselves up for potentially a big fall when federal legalization does come through in the US. I know that Canopy Growth again has their partnership with Acreage Holdings, and that's a big expectation. And there's a lot of expectations still around Canopy Growth, but when you compare them to a multi-state operator in the US, who again also had to go through COVID-19 difficulties. And a lot of companies, it's not like just Canopy Growth was the only one affected by COVID-19, but they did have the highest amount of layoffs. They did have the least amount of profit. They did have not a very good sales growth. And a lot of companies actually improved their financial numbers during COVID-19 because they were smart, because they actually had efficient business models. And again, when you look at multi-state operators that are starting to be cash flow positive, that are starting to be really profitable and bringing in big numbers right now, and their stocks are going up, and people are excited, and the market is responding, and then you look at the Canadian counterparts, it's difficult to see a long-term future for many of these large-scale Canadian producers without them either just falling into obscurity, collapsing under the weight of themselves, or again being just basically dissected by other counterparts over time in the US who will buy up piece by piece of these companies. And again, most of the brand recognition is coming from US brands. And even the CBD products that are being launched into the US are not doing well versus their US counterparts. So, I think this is something to pay attention to, and I'm sure many people are already paying attention to the floundering that Canopy Growth is creating. There again are some upsides to this company occasionally, but I think that there's also been a lot of real tough stuff for them to go through, and having these types of articles written about them, which are accurate, and having these types of announcements come out, I don't think are doing them any favors in the long term. And it's definitely not looking super ideal right now for the large scale Canadian producers, not just excluding Canopy Growth. Like I said, they are the one who's under the heat today. But I think that many of them are need to seriously start readdressing their business strategies and seriously start making some real moves to gain some public support, gain some nice public opinion, and also really prove that they're worth what people speculate that they could be worth, because I think that right now it's been all speculation for a lot of these companies, and it's time to put up or shut up for a lot of them. Moving on to Delek Holdings Incorporated, the leading psychedelic wellness platform, who announced today that Itafeo Harvey will serve as one of the event's main stage speakers. Meet Delek is the world's premier psychedelic and wellness edutainment event, catering to both curious newcomers, businesses, and thought leaders. And Harvey is the founder and board president of the People of Color Psychedelic Collective, longtime advocate for promoting drug policies grounded in science, compassion, and human rights, as well as the social media manager for Caring Across Generations, an organization which creates a new way to live well and age with dignity in America. Now, Harvey stated, "I'm excited to push the boundaries of how we talk and think about wellness in our society at Meet Delek. I want our society to truly value and create wellness for everyone." And during her tenure at the Drug Policy Alliance, which was the nation's leading organization advocating for the end of the war on drugs, Harvey fought hard for people who no longer be punished for what the people put in their bodies, and this created a deep desire with Harvey to further champion that individuals be given the sovereign right and choice to use alternative medicines such as psychedelics without fear of impunity. Now, the experiential event will feature dancers, music, 3D mapping, new technologies and research, thought-provoking presentations, and the world's largest psychedelic business expo. It's an honor to have Idafeo Harvey speak at our conference and bring her unique perspective on health, life, and culture to our attendees, said Delic co-founder Jackie Stang. Now, she's a powerful voice in the movement toward embracing psychedelic wellness and reform, and her work to the right of many wrongs in the war on drugs is remarkable. Now, the 20 hours of panels and keynotes will include a broad array of topics such as how psychedelics can be effectively used for physical optimization, PTSD reset and recovery, ketamine clinics today, psilocybin and MDMA therapy tomorrow, microdosing activism, sexuality, and drug use for grownups. And there will also be musical entertainment acts, and they're scheduled for both evenings following the panels and expo. Now, tickets are now available for the two-day expo. And you can visit meetdelic.com or follow them on Instagram or Facebook, and they are again now available. I'm really hopeful of how this conference is going to go. I think that having Idafeo is going to be quite cool for the conference of speakers. They have a lot of very interesting guests and attendees who are going to be there, a lot of different businesses. And I do think if you've been paying attention to the amount of drug reform policy going on throughout the US and Canada and really globally towards psychedelics, towards decriminalizing them, towards legalizing them, I think that that is as close or very close now. I think that you're going to see this within the next 2 years. Many countries are going to have a big change on how they view everyone's using the new term entheogens. As opposed to psychedelics, which I do think is much more beneficial to the industry. Same with, I mean, cannabis has focused more on cannabis versus marijuana or weed. And I do think that that is part of the game of how you change the cultural perception of these drugs. And I do think with psychedelics specifically, too many people have heard personal stories of people's lives vastly improving either from microdosing or having a psychedelic retreat or having a just one good psychedelic experience. And I do think that there's going to be some really crazy stuff coming down the pipe when it comes to psychedelics, when it comes to the idea of what consciousness is in our society today. And hopefully that changes for the good, and hopefully there is no reverse on that, because I do think that in the past there has been this uptick, obviously in the 60s and 70s, 50s and 60s more so. People were very excited about psychedelics, and then it all turned into a big shit pile. And there is always the potential of that in our world today, but I do think that very much right now the genie's out of the bottle, and I think that most people are awake to the fact that psychedelics can be vastly beneficial to many people's lives, to many people's health. And I do hope that in these panels and in this psychedelic conference, as Harvey stated, that people are willing to push the boundaries of how we talk about this. Because I do think that everyone still is playing it very safe, very scientific, using a lot of medical terminology, using a lot of very safe language, and really only talking about the medical side of this industry as opposed to just the real life side of this industry, which is that many people, there's, you know, potentially millions, if not more, who are and have been taking these drugs, illicitly or illegally for many years now and have reaped the benefits of these compounds. And I do think that that needs to start being addressed more aggressively. And we need to stop bullshitting around about the reality that, again, are we adults? Should we be allowed to put products in our body? If we're allowed to put cigarettes in our body, why the hell can we not put psychedelics in our body? Who the fuck is telling us that we are not allowed or responsible enough to control our own conscious thinking? And I hear this sometimes in some of these conferences or in some of these interviews, etc. But I do think it needs to be a much more louder and aggressive voice because, again, I think that there's a lot of people who are suffering needlessly without access to these types of drugs. And many people, even with mental conditions, I mean, that to me is where I find the biggest interest in psychedelics is for autism and for people who are suffering from severe mental conditions. They could really benefit from some of these treatments, and we could change a lot of families' lives for the better in such a dramatic way that it could be insane. And I do think that hopefully this is what happens, but you never know. Lastly today, looking at Ketamine One Capital Limited, a company focused on consolidating medical clinics and becoming North America leader in mental health treatments, who announced it signed an exclusive agreement for the use of virtual reality technology in psychedelic treatments with OVR Tech LLC to provide its Inhale Wellness platform over an initial term of 2 years in Ketamine One's clinics. Now, the Inhale Wellness platform is an olfactory-enabled VR platform designed to deepen immersion, promote relaxation, and help manage stress. Now, the concept for the architecture of the Scent or Ion device was based on the idea for Scent in VR could dramatically increase immersion. So we believe that the Ion device contains the most accurate on-mass scent technology currently available on the market. This ability for our clinicians to alter perceptual experiences with VR and the Ions is extremely promising. Optimizing the therapeutic setting is one of the main goals of our VR-based research and development program, and being able to utilize the sense of smell to help patients relax, reduce tension, and lower stress is expected to result in the development of comprehensive treatment, said Dr. Quang Henderson, chair of Ketamine One's Clinic Innovation Council. Now, this is the first VR platform that understands users' behavior in the virtual world and responds with real-time sensory stimulation, and has the potential to significantly enhance the wellness capabilities of an already promising technology, said Aaron Wisniewski, CEO and co-founder of OVR Technology. Now, this may seem like a very minor thing, but I gotta say, I am losing my shit over this being a reality right now, because I've talked about this with my friends and family for a couple of years now. As someone who's really loved and been very interested in researching on VR technology, as well as been very much into the psychedelic space, it may sound a little wacky, but this is kind of how we get borderline Matrix-esque VR tech in our life, is through the combination of psychedelics and VR technology. And right now, obviously, it's just for therapeutic help, and I think that it'll be massively beneficial. But imagine the idea of wearing a VR headset. You have sensory olfactory sense stimulation, so smell. You also have haptic feedback suits, so touch. And then you have maybe a slow drip of ketamine or DMT or psilocybin or LSD through an IV system or through a precise dosage system. I don't know what that system would look like today, but there's lots of options on the horizon, and we are getting much more consistent with dosage knowledge and dosage understanding. And I think that there's going to be some wacky stuff coming out in the future when you think about the capabilities of gaming or anything, whether this is for therapy, whether this is for soldiers, whether this is for people suffering from extreme trauma. There's a lot of applications for this, but there are some unnerving applications for this as well, in that people could get extremely lost in these VR simulations. If they are having this much sensory information, it'll be tough to come out of that dream when you go back into your regular world and you've been completely mind raped basically for the last hour or two. So while I think that this is so awesome that this is existing, it is also one of the most unnerving partnerships that I've ever seen, because I've talked about this in a hypothetical situation for a couple years now, and I really did not expect this to be on the horizon as fast as it is. And the fact that there's companies looking into it right now means that soon there's going to be more companies looking into it. And there is a constant connection between the world of gaming and the world of cannabis and psychedelics. Many of the same investors are in both those same beds. Many of the same customers are in both of those same beds. And I do think that there's a real potential for a cross-melding of those platforms over the next decade or so that could create some groundbreaking and possibly insane technology that could allow people to simulate that would be indistinguishable from your regular sensory life, if not more enhanced than regular sensory perception that you see as your regular everyday reality. Because again, psychedelics are a powerful, powerful thing. They can already mess with your mind on such an extreme degree, especially at higher doses. I can attest to that personally. They can really send you into a different dimension. And if you are adding a very, very advanced VR headset with, again, things like haptic feedback, the fact that they have this OVR Technologies Inhale Ion device that, again, is affecting your olfactory senses, that's pretty much all of your senses. There's nothing really left after that. And again, if all of those can be hacked that aggressively, you know, obviously it's a little tinfoil hat to say that like we're entering the Matrix, but to some extent, that type of technology is now on the horizon being worked on, and something to be very wary of and very aware of over the next decade, because I think that that is going to have some groundbreaking medical breakthroughs. But also, there is always a dark side to every piece of technology, and the dark side to that is pretty unnerving. That's all for today's podcast. Thank you for listening, and enjoy the rest of your Wednesday.
That's all for today's podcast. Podcast is now a certified word trademark on the blockchain through Cognate Incorporated ZM certification. InvestorIdeas.com podcasts are also available on iTunes, Spotify, Google Play Music, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, Spreaker, and TuneIn. If you'd like to be a guest or sponsor of this podcast, please contact InvestorIdeas.com. Investor Ideas reminds all listeners to read our disclaimers and disclosures on the InvestorIdeas.com website, and this podcast is not an endorsement to buy products or services or securities. Investors are reminded that all investments involve risk and possible loss of investment. Investor Ideas does not condone the use of cannabis except where permissible by law. Our site does not possess, distribute, or sell cannabis products.